to understand what God has willed, what God has planned. I only know at his right hand stands.
Good morning, church. Welcome. We're so glad you came to join us this morning.
Here with your good news, I'm Aubrey Lee.
And I'm Eric.
And here's what's happening at SEC.
Here to tell us more about what all the hype is about this men's breakfast is our very own McKibben Womack. Hey.
Hey.
McKibben.
In the flesh.
Exactly. Yeah. What's the deal with the football?
What is the deal with football?
And
Lambeau Field.
Lambeau Field.
And dudes.
And dudes.
You gotta come October 7th, 8 a.m. in the Fireside Room to find out.
And now we're gonna go to Aubrey on location. Aubrey, are you there? Can you hear me? Hello?
Thank you, Eric. I am here in the Fireside Room with the lovely Esther Baker. She is here to give us a sneak peek at something coming up for the women this coming Saturday. Thank you for being here, Esther. What is coming up this Saturday for our women?
So this Saturday, here in the Fireside Room, we are having our women's fall evening dinner.
Fantastic. So what can the women expect from this dinner?
So they're going to hear from a local author, Nancy Carmichael, and she's going to be talking to us about taking time to pause and reflect. And we're also going to have the opportunity to bless one of our families who is serving in Central Asia.
Oh, that's wonderful. Is there anything we need to know that the women need to know before attending on Saturday?
Yeah, registration is really important. We are providing childcare, and so we want to be able to plan ahead for that.
That is awesome. Thank you so much. I'm so excited, and I will register. Where can I register?
You can find registration at the back of the sanctuary, and you can also find a link on the invitation card to take you to the online registration.
Awesome. That sounds so easy. Well, thank you for being here, Esther.
You're welcome.
And back to you, Eric, in the studio.
Childcare. I wonder if I check myself into childcare, I can still get free dinner.
Part two of Patriots, Pietists, and Prophets comes to you October 15th.
It's our third Sunday men's gathering in the Fireside Room. They will be continuing the conversation about our political cultural issues facing our nation. Hey, you know, you got some pretty good ninja skills.
Thanks for noticing.
Yeah.
I just don't know what to do with them.
Did you know that at the Welcome Center, there's a form you can fill out for any kind of skills or interests so you can get plugged in here at the church?
That's awesome. So if you're like me and you have some skills or interests and want to help in the ministry at SCC, go and fill out a form in the Welcome Center because we'd love to get you plugged in.
And just as a friendly reminder, the doors open at 9 o'clock, so feel free to come join us early, grab your seats, get some coffee, catch up with your friends, maybe drop your kids off, because church starts at
9:30
a.m.
That's right, 9:30 a.m. sharp.
On the dot.
And that is your good news for today.
For more information, go to sisterschurch.com. Take care.
And thanks for joining us. See what we did there.
Where did Aubrey go?
Good morning. Good morning. I'm going to invite you guys to stand up and worship with us. Where our first song is, Your Love Awakens Me. And so we just, God, thank you for first loving us so we may love others. We love you so much, and we're going to praise you this morning.
Feel free to lift your hands, sing along, lift your voice. Let's just worship God together. Amen. Let's sing these words together from our hearts to God. There are walls between us. By the cross you came and broke them down. You broke them down. And there are chains around us. But by your grace we are no longer bound. No longer bound. You call me out of the grave. You call me into the light. You call my name and then my heart came alive. Your love is greater. Your love is stronger. Your love awakens, awakens, awakens me. Your love is greater. Your love is stronger. God, for your grace, for your mercy, for your love that never ends. Feel the darkness shaking, all the dead are coming back to life, back to life. And hear the song awaken, all creation singing, we're alive, cause you're alive. Call me out of the grave, you called me into the light, you called my name and then my heart came alive. Your love is greater, your love is stronger, your love awakens, awakens, awakens me. Your love is greater, your love is stronger. Sing about his love together, church.
What a love we found. Death can't hold us down. We shout it out. We're alive because you're alive. Oh, what a love we found. Death can't hold us down. We shout it out. We're alive because you're alive. Oh, shout it out, we're alive, cause you're alive.
Thank you, Lord.
Your love is greater, your love is stronger. Your love awakens, awakens, awakens me. Your love is greater, your love is stronger. Your love awakens, awakens, awakens me. Your love is greater. Your love is stronger. Your love awakens, awakens, awakens me. Your love is greater. Your love is stronger. Your love awakens, awakens, awakens me.
God, we worship you.
sinners. Come find his mercy. Come to the table. He will satisfy. Taste of his goodness. Find what you're looking for. For God so loved the world that he gave us his one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever. Is waiting there with open arms. Yes, he is open arms. For God so loved the world that he gave us his one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever.
It is dark, but I
Savior, he will stay.
On a hill of Calvary, my Savior bled for me. My Jesus set me free. Thank you, Lord. And look at the wounds that give me life, grace flowing from his side. No greater sacrifice. What he's done, all the glory and the honor to the Son. My sins are forgiven, my future is heaven, and I praise God for what he's done.
Thank you, Lord. freedom he has won. Even death is dead and done. His life has overcome.
Yes, he has.
Speak, say the name above all names, over every broken place. He is risen from the grave. And what he's done, all the glory and the honor to the Son. My sins are forgiven. My future is heaven, and I praise God for what he's done. And now, on the throne of majesty, the Father's will complete, and he reigns in victory.
Aren't you glad, church?
Yeah. And sing hallelujah to the King. He is worthy to receive all the worship we can bring.
Yes, he is.
We sing hallelujah to the King. He is worthy to receive all the worship we can. What he's done, what he's done. All the glory and the honor to the Son. My sins are forgiven. Oh, my future is heaven. And I praise God for what he's done. I praise God for what he's done.
Yes, God, thank you, Lord, for your grace, for your mercy. Thank you that your love never fails us, never leaves us. God, that you rescued us and redeemed us by the power of the cross. So we worship you, God, not just with our lips, but with every ounce and every inch of who we are. Joining with all creation, shouting your praise this morning, God. Have your will, have your way. Transform us this morning, God. In Jesus' name, and God's people said, amen.
Amen. Good morning, and you can be seated. Welcome to Sisters Community Church. I'm Ryan. I'm one of the pastors here, and I'm so glad you're here this morning. And before the kids and students get dismissed, one thing we do every Sunday is we have a family of the week, and so this week it's a great family. They've been a cornerstone staple of the Sisters community a long, long, long time. And so that is the Gurney family. So Jim and Chris, are you guys here somewhere? I didn't see you. Oh, they're right here. Yeah, okay, cool. So yeah, you can clap for them. They're great people. Yeah. Let me tell you a little bit about the Gurneys. There's a lot to love about these two, but one of the things that I love about them is that they both take seriously even some of the things we're going to talk about this morning in the message. And what I mean by that is they actually see their vocation. Jim as a business owner, Chris as a teacher, I think over the web, so I think she's in her online and in cars doing home visits. They both see their vocation as a mission field, as ministry. And a few months ago, Jim was in front of the church talking about how his business is really a tool for discipleship. And they're involved in a lot of things, and Chris with hospitality and women's Bible study, Jim with discipling whoever's sitting in the truck next to him or coaching football. And so these guys really model a beautiful lifestyle that we could all learn from. And the other thing I really love, I'm sure Chris is this way, I haven't had as many personal interactions with her, but with Jim, I gotta say, is there's a real soft heart. And that's one thing I love about Jim. So we just wanna pray for these guys and pray for what they're doing. And If you've watched any sisters football, you'll see Gurney out there. He's pretty passionate about everything. He's doing all sorts of hand signals. I don't know what he's doing, but he's pumped, okay? So join me in just praying over the Gurneys this morning. And Father, thank you for Jim and Chris. Thank you for their children. And thank you, God, for longevity in one place for the long haul. Thanks for what that does for a church. Thank you for what it does for a community. Thank you for what that does for friendships and for Jim's years as a pastor here, his years as an elder here. Whatever he's been called to, he's given himself to it. So I pray, God, for fruitful years of ministry for both of them. Increase their capacity to affect kingdom change in this community. We pray, God, that both of them continue to have powerful interactions, especially with those who are far from you, and they would show people up close and personal the love of Jesus. Make it real through them, God. Thank you for this time. Thank you for the chance to be together. We pray for the Gurneys, and we pray for our time as we open up Scripture this morning. In Christ's name, amen. Kids, you guys are dismissed. Middle schoolers, you're going with Pastor Dustin Smith down to the hangar. So middle schoolers can meet in the back, and apparently it's a pancake feed for the middle schoolers. No adult, I see a couple adult men. No, sit down, guys. No, you're going to get the bread of life. Stay here, okay? Oh, my gosh. A couple of guys are like, I'm out. I need a short stack of seven. No, stay here. Hey, good morning. Glad you're here. I'm Ryan. I'm one of the pastors here, and really glad you're with us. If you're brand new amongst us this morning at Sisters Community Church, right after the service today, there's a welcome center out in the foyer. We want to say hello, make sure we get your name, who you are, and how we can help you, how we can serve you, okay? We are looking at the letter of Corinthians, so if you have your Bibles, you can open up to 1 Corinthians chapter 2. And I want to start with just a question that I want you to ponder with me this morning. The question I want us to begin with this morning is maybe a simple one, but without thinking deeply about the simple things, sometimes we can miss the thing. And so the question I want you to think about with me is, what is the unique message or the unique value proposition that we have as the people of Jesus? Another way to ask this question is what makes the church the church? What makes what we're doing different than another 501c3? Just down the road. Or maybe you've been in a position like our youth pastor was recently, Dustin Smith. Dustin is doing an awesome job working with the students, but recently he had tragedy hit his life as one of his childhood friends was in a motorcycle accident going over 100 miles an hour. And he got the call that Nick was on life support, but they were going to try and revive him one last time so he could say goodbye. And as Dustin drove to see Nick, what's the one thing that Dustin wants to make sure Nick has? What's the one thing that we have as the church? What's the one thing Paul had that caused him to say no to everything else? Because we are going to have a definitive, singular, lead passion. And by definition, that lead passion will rise to the top and push away the peripheral things. And friends, when you know this, there's no atheists in the foxhole. That life has ultimates, and when you're driving to that ICU room to see your childhood friend, you don't have time for peripheral silliness. In business, this idea of one thing. It's been made popular by an author named Jim Collins, who wrote a book called Good to Great. And in the book Good to Great, he's got the hedgehog concept. Anyone heard of the hedgehog concept? The hedgehog concept, it's simple. It's based on the ancient Greek parable that states this premise that the fox knows many things. The hedgehog knows one big thing. And in this parable, the fox uses many strategies to try and catch the hedgehog. It sneaks, it pounces, it races. Sometimes the fox even plays dead. Parable, and he said, what's the lesson here? The fox never learns that the hedgehog knows how to do one big thing perfectly: defend itself. But here's the critical thing. Whether it's the church, whether it's the hedgehog, or whether it's a business, whatever that one thing is that you've decided, you better protect it. And you better make sure you deliver on it. You know what I'm talking about here? I went to a restaurant recently that prided itself on fresh, local, healthy lunches. Was with a group of four. First person ordered a salad. Said, sorry, we're out of that. Okay. The next person said, I'd like to try the vegetarian sandwich. They're like, we're out of that. So finally, we just said, well, what do you have? Let's go with that, right? Whatever you say is your one thing, you better deliver. Going to the coffee house, saying, can I get a latte? We're out of that. Can I get a house coffee? Don't got it. What do you got? Apple cider. You've lost the plot, okay? The church has a unique, razor-focused, Holy Spirit-directed, biblically saturated mission. It's got a vision and it's got a bullseye. And listen, friends, when the church loses that, it loses everything. Have any of you seen in your lifetime institutional drift? I went back to look. Every Ivy League school was founded on orthodoxy. At hospitals today where they're doing, quote, gender-affirming care, many of these hospitals were founded on biblically orthodox kingdom of God orientation. And so here's the principle I want you to hear. Whatever that one thing is, if you don't protect it and you don't say that's the one thing with clarity, with precision, other passions will come in. It'll creep and vision leaks. And so we come to this text this morning. We look at the Apostle Paul. And he's going to say some very potent things. And he's going to say, there's a lot of things I could do. There's a lot of things that the Corinthian church needs. There's a lot of things we could talk about. I'm going to talk about one thing. Because Paul understands he's been with Jesus and the people of Jesus, and it's Jesus himself who said about the church, the people of God, the people of the cross. Jesus himself said on the Sermon on the Mount, if salt loses its saltiness, it's good for nothing except to be trampled. It's our distinctiveness that causes the world to look and wonder. And so we come to this text this morning looking and asking, God, what is that one thing? Let's read the scriptures here in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 1 through 5. Paul says this, when I came to you, brothers, I did not come proclaiming to you the testimony of God with lofty speech or wisdom. For I decided to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. I was with you in weakness and in fear and in much trembling. And my speech and my message were not in plausible words of wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power, so that your faith might not rest in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. Father, as we look at this power-packed five verses this morning, God, there's so many peripheral things that want to hijack us this morning. There's good things that we could give ourselves to, but Lord, would you help us see the one thing from Paul? Would you help us see the singular vision, the singular passion? And would we find ourselves awakened again with that kind of clarity in our own hearts? So help us and help me this morning. Amen. What is the unique proposition of the church? What makes the church is the question we asked. Nonprofits, they do a lot of good stuff. Habitat for Humanity, amazing. It's cool to see houses being built for people we love in our community. PRC, the Pregnancy Resource Center, amazing. They're advocating for the unborn. They're saving parents from the pain of abortion. It's a great ministry. Homeless shelters, addiction treatment places, all great things. Great stuff, but what makes the church unique is that we preach Christ crucified. This last week, I went to a business forum in Bend. It was a big meeting, and had the opportunity to sit with four young men from a ministry in Bend called Teen Challenge. Teen Challenge is an amazing ministry, and what they do is they meet people stuck in the cycle of addiction. And they walk them through a program. And I was just asking these guys. It was cool. I mean, they were all, you know, huge earrings, big tattoos. And I was very out of place. It was like a missions trip, cultural distance to dive in with these guys, asking them questions about their life. And all of them, without exception, said, the program, the point of the program is we got to get people to Jesus because only Jesus can change a life. They understood the centrality of Paul's message here. And Paul's going to say, what's the one thing? The one thing is Christ crucified. And so I want to just show you a chart here because sometimes we kind of pit maybe good works or gospel proclamation. We kind of make this conflated argument. And I want to just show you what this looks like, maybe from a New Testament perspective. So what you see here is good works minus gospel proclamation equals what I call temporal improvement. So it's great to dig wells. That's a good thing. Awesome. We should do that. I know one church, they wanted to like clean the city and get the garbage off the town. Good idea. Let's do that. Awesome. But good works minus gospel proclamation, it's temporal. It's not eternal. It's just for a moment. It's important, but it's not ultimate. And so the next paradigm is this gospel proclamation minus good works. I call it elusive idealism. It's awesome news, but how does it affect my life? That's great. Jesus wants to save me. What's that got to do with my life of addiction? What's that got to do with my life of financial instability? What's that got to do with my life of broken relationships? So gospel proclamation minus good works, it's this elusive idealism that sounds really good, but my felt experience, my practical experience, it's hard to grab. But this gospel proclamation plus good works is what I call the power of God. And once you really know and really experience and really understand, you'll fight for what Paul fought for. You'll find yourself saying, we cannot lose our witness in gospel proclamation. We'll become protective of it. We'll become protective of what our content and our doctrine is in our church. Paul did this with his ministry philosophy. So I want to just give you three things this morning from this passage. Number one, how Paul came. Number two, what Paul brought, and number three, why Paul did it this way. You guys ready? You guys ready? Let's go. Here we go. How Paul came. Chapter 2, verse 1, when I came to you, brothers, here's how I did not come. I did not come to you proclaiming the testimony of God with lofty speech or wisdom. Paul didn't come to be impressive. Paul didn't come to build a brand. Paul didn't come to build a persona. Paul could have. He was going to a community, and Jonathan talked about this last week, that was very impressed with the Greek word is Sophia. It's the goddess of wisdom. And Paul could have played that game. He could have been impressive. But he said, I came deliberately different. Why did Paul do that? Verse 3, I was with you. Here's how he came. I was with you in weakness and in fear and in much trembling. Paul comes with what I call a bad resume. Just for fun this week, I got on a website. In this website, they recruit pastors for big churches all over the nation. I was like, I want to see what this senior pastor job is for this church of 3,000 people. I read the job description, all 57 pages of it. My conclusion, Paul would not be qualified. Ryan would not be qualified. Steve would definitely not be qualified. And Jesus, maybe, right? What, now, we laugh. Why? What's going? Well, here's what's happened. We've exchanged the glory of weakness for the wisdom of Sophia. We've been allured in by the narrative of Babylon instead of enamored with the wisdom of the king. And so Paul comes with a bad resume. It's the same resume he brought up in Acts chapter 20, where he was talking to the elders in Ephesus, and he says, I was with you with humility, with tears, and with trials. Paul models a forgotten leadership attribute in the scriptures, the glory of weakness. Paul wanted to be weak. Because Paul's going to say at the end of this, your faith today, it can rest on the persona of a person, or it can rest on the power of God, but it can't rest on both. And Paul wanted to look weak because he was weak. Flip over to 2 Corinthians. Let's parse this out a little bit. This is Paul's probably fourth letter to the Corinthian church. In our Bibles, it's 2 Corinthians. So he writes to these guys in 2 Corinthians chapter 1. I mean, this is an amazing little passage here. In 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 3 and following, he says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our afflictions so that we might be able to comfort those who are in any affliction with the comfort which we ourselves are comforted by God. Paul says our weakness isn't a problem because God's comfort is stronger than our weakness. Verse 5, as we share abundantly in Christ's sufferings, so through Christ we also share abundantly in comfort also. If we are afflicted, it is for your comfort and salvation, and if we are comforted, it is for your comfort, which you experience when you patiently endure the same sufferings that we suffer. Now look at verse 9. He says, this is how bad things are. Indeed, we felt that we had received the sentence of death, but that was to make us rely not on ourselves, but on God who raises the dead. God, make me reliant on you. Make me humble and reliant on you. What does God do? brings a trial into our lives, what do we pray? God, get me out of this trial. Paul says, God brought a trial, and the discomfort and the affliction was so intense, it made him not rely on himself, but on God. Later in 2 Corinthians 12, it's the climax of Paul's interaction with the Corinthian church. It's that very famous passage where Paul says, I will boast about my weakness, because when I am weak, then I am strong. And so Paul comes to this church with weakness. And so I want to tell you this morning, if you feel weak, if you feel unqualified, if you feel too old, if you feel too young, if you feel like you're not hip enough, you're not good enough, you're not dressed good enough, you're not rich enough, you're not with it enough, you're in great company. Moses said, who am I? I'm slow of tongue. David was the forgotten son. Samuel just say, Jesse, I think you have another son. And Jesse goes, yeah, he's just a little shepherd. Don't worry about him. No, that's the guy. Daniel and his buddies were teenagers when they overtook the empire. And Jesus, the climax of all human history, was born as the lowest of lows and the poorest of poor. Your weakness, your insecurity, your fear, and your trembling is an asset in the kingdom of God, not a liability. And I think I need to make this point clear this morning. We now live in a hostile world to the way of Jesus. And so it's a real opportunity to actually receive persecution, to be hated, to be called narrow-minded, to be called all kinds of things. And it's a real opportunity to say, that's uncomfortable. And Paul says, you're in good company if you feel discomfort with that. That's how Paul came. He came with weakness, with fear, and with trembling. Number two, what did Paul bring? Verse 2, I decided to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. Wait a minute, Paul. What about the marriage seminar? What about the parenting class? What about the end times charts? What about the financial class? You got one sermon? Paul's got one sermon. Imagine coming every week, it's just Paul, one sermon. Same sermon. Now, the rest of the letter, what we're going to see Paul do is he's going to talk about a lot of these things. He's going to talk about marriage. He's going to talk about our sexual ethics. He's going to talk about how we come to church. He's going to talk about giving generously. He's going to talk about all that. But listen, those are the fruits. The root is the gospel. Those are the effects. The cause is Christ crucified. And so, friends, if we don't tether our sanctification to the gospel, we end up in merit-based moral reformation, and that will end in pride or despair. And so Paul's going to tether everything to the gospel. Because, listen, we can't be good parents without the gospel. You want to know why? Because your children come out of the womb kicking and screaming and raising hell, and you're going to need a lot of grace to forgive them and forgive yourself for responding to them. We can't have marriage the way God wants it without the gospel. Why? Because you're going to sin against your spouse more than anyone in your life. Michelle and I were going through a book together, and we were talking through some stuff this last week, and we both, in a moment of vulnerability, said, yeah, you've probably hurt me more than anyone else in my life, and I love you, and I'm totally committed. There's no marriage without the gospel. There's no parenting without the gospel. There's no new community without the gospel. So Paul's going to tether everything to the gospel. And so I want to show you this, what this looks like. This is a chart from a book that I love called The Gospel-Centered Life. And in this chart, what you're going to see is, here's the chart. Do you see it? Okay, there, yeah. What's up? What you see up here is there's a moment of conversion, and then you have a line going up, And in that line going up is, it's an infinite line. It's a growing awareness of God's holiness. It's not that God's becoming more holy, but as you grow in Christ, you're more and more amazed of the character of this God. Isn't that true how it works? Those of you who have been walking with Jesus a long time, isn't that true? You become more and more amazed at how holy God is, how good he is. But there's also a line going down, and that's an infinite line too. And that line is a growing awareness of our own sinfulness. It's not that we're becoming more sinful. It's that we're becoming more aware that everything that we do has a little bit of me-centered angle to it. Our old pastor, Stu Weber, said one time, "I don't think I've ever done anything in life with a pure motive." Everyone said amen. I mean, it was crazy, but we do even good things at times with an angle at improving how people perceive us. We want people to like us. And so this chasm just keeps getting wider and wider and wider. And what you'll see is that we can shrink the cross. We can let religion or moralism or self-justification or legalism or pride up at the top or at the bottom. We can live in guilt and in shame and insecurity. And so the cross never gets bigger. It just is what it is. But the next slide, you'll see what happens when we stop performing and we stop pretending. The cross, do you guys see the cross? It just keeps getting bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger. And this is why Paul said in Galatians chapter 6, "May I never boast except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ." As we see who we really are and who he really is, it just lets the cross be big. And when the cross is big, you know what happens, friends? We become okay to talk about how we're not okay, because we've trusted the one who's bridged the gap. We become, what one author says, we become inoffendable because we know we're the offender. And the cross stays big. So Paul says the gospel. And why the gospel? Here's why the gospel. People's lives are ruined without the gospel. My least favorite pastoral moments in my life was as a youth pastor. At least once a year, I would have broken-hearted middle schoolers and high schoolers come into my office to tell me their daddy's moving out. Friends, that's an insurmountable. It's an insurmountable obstacle in the heart of a young person. People's lives are ruined. Families are ruined. Marriages are ruined. Relationships are ruined. Things that fall from order to chaos without the gospel. We forget this in the church. We forget the vivid picture in Titus 3 where it says, without the grace of God, we were hated and hated one another. It's relational animosity without the gospel. People are trapped and we've been given the keys. And Paul says this, "I came to you with nothing except Jesus Christ crucified." And so I just want to make a point this morning. Whoever gets up here to talk, we better have gospel proclamation, the good news to announce that there's a way out of the chaos. Jesus Christ took the punishment. He took the pain. He died. He rose again, and he can raise us to newness of life, and that's the good news. We don't have to stay stuck. Praise God for that. So what's Paul's motivation, lastly? Why did Paul do it this way? What was Paul trying to do? Verse 5. "So that your faith might not rest in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God." I looked at a study this week from Barna Research. They do a lot of statistics with churches. And they asked pastors anonymously, quote, the question was this, quote, can you run your church, honestly, can you run your church, can you guys do what you do without the Holy Spirit? Overwhelmingly, evangelical American pastors, I think embarrassingly, but honestly said, yeah, probably. Don't you want to have a mission and a task so audacious, so massive, so soul-crushing that the only possible solution would be the power of God? Don't you want to be pressed in something where we can't manage our way out of it? By the way, that's exactly what God's doing right now. Can we manage our way out of this? Can we just, you know, get the power back and get our country back? Probably not. It's going to take a massive move of God. This is where we're at in the moment we live in. Cultural Christianity is dying out, or it might just be flat dead. What our children are facing today is absolutely insane. I love what Mark Sayers says in his book, Disappearing Church. Listen to this. He says, continuing the same things that are not bringing renewal is not going to bring renewal. Lack of commitment is not going to bring renewal. Business as usual, that won't bring renewal. Accumulating knowledge without putting it into practice will not bring renewal. We need our autopilot patterns interrupted. Much of the Western church is operating on the kinetic forward motion of previous moves of God, lounging on a platform built by the service and ministry of past and passing generations. However, the fuel tank is approaching empty. See, if we get the power back, but the hearts aren't changed, all we've done is moral reformation. And we need regeneration. God wants to do the work, but he wants to do it from the inside out. We need the power of God. I love what Corrie Ten Boom said. And if you know her story at all, you know her life. Put this on display. She says, trying to do the Lord's work in your own strength is the most confusing, exhausting, and tedious work of all. But when you are filled with the Holy Spirit, then the ministry of Jesus just flows out of you. Isn't that what Jesus said? Believe in me and out of you is going to come flowing rivers of living water. And let me just say this. Our culture is thirsty. There are signposts everywhere in our culture today of a cultural thirst, a cultural hunger, a cultural moment that we live in where the culture is longing. And we have been given the keys to the kingdom. We have been given this living water. Our job is to let it flow out of us. So whose job is it to do this work of gospel proclamation? It's your job, Ryan, right? It's you and Steve. You guys need, and I would say yes. And then I would say, but as the community of faith, it's our job. Who announces the good news of the kingdom of God? Who are you rubbing shoulders with and in community with who needs to hear the simple gospel that they don't have to stay stuck in sin and in shame and in isolation? We together, formally and informally, announce this message of the crucified Messiah. And so I want to just show you a way we can do that. Jonathan Martin taught our church this a couple years ago. I want to show you. This is the interactive portion of the morning. Everyone take your hands, put them out right here, okay? Okay. We're not going to give you a tract, but you all got hands, okay? Say connection. Okay. We were made for relationship with God, okay? We broke that relationship. So say disconnection. We went down. We went outside the garden. Jesus came, and he gives us reconnection, and then he lifts us up, and he gives us real connection, okay? I want you to practice that on somebody this week, okay? Because we all rub up against people that need the good news of King Jesus at our gyms, our restaurants, our AA meetings, our community events, our ball games. We're not just hanging out, trying to have a good time and a good life. We are sent ambassadors to a community representing King Jesus and his kingdom and the good news that Christ is king. Now, I want to close by showing you a very powerful magazine cover. This is April 8th, 1966. Does anyone remember this cover? Some of you just haze yourself because it was 1966, okay? Culture was in a tumultuous time. Racial tensions were heightened. There was cultural despair. There was fighting over whether we should be in war. Very similar to the moment we're living in. And in that moment, Time magazine comes and asks the old Nietzsche question, is God dead? Moral decay is at an all-time high. Crime, there's a palpable hopelessness in the air. The future looks dim. And during this time, there was this guy named Billy Graham. And Graham saw the malformation of society, and Graham said, I'm not going to live under the deformation strategy. I'm going to do something else. I'm going to do a reformation. And his whole ministry was built on, how many of you guys have been to a Billy Graham crusade? Anybody? Okay. I've been to, I think, two. First off, a lot of people there. Second thing I would say, as a young man, I remember thinking, this is not profounded. Like, when you listen to Billy Graham, you're not writing down quotes like it's Tim Keller. It's really simple. He gets up and he just like explains the gospel. And what happens? Whole city saved. You're like, what in the world, man? Like, I've tried this a lot and no one's ever done that, right? I'm doing it right now and nobody raised their hand. I'm like, I'm a little mad at Billy, you know? God bless you, Billy, right? So Billy Graham makes this his aim and he looks at the hopelessness of the day, not as an obstacle. He sees it as the great opportunity. Despair is the prerequisite to renewal. The hopelessness of the culture is actually the currency Graham uses. And let me just tell you two men that were indirectly influenced by this. The first was my grandpa. Didn't know Christ at all. But through this evangelism effort, probably somewhere in a spiritual family tree, it goes back to a guy named Billy Graham. But the second one that I thought was really interesting is I was talking with my good friend Tim Green this week, who's part of our church, and his parents, Robin and Lawrence, are part of our church here. And he said, we were talking about the power of the gospel, and he said something that I just thought, wow. He said, Ryan, I don't know if you know this, but my dad became a Christian by reading one of those little gospel tracts on his way to Vietnam. Friends, we think it's our performance. We think it's like, do we have the most compelling, good, thoughtful stage and props? We don't need props. We need the power of God. And so the gospel is enough. And so one famous author puts it this way, Jesus plus nothing equals everything. And you have been given the message. And it's not you. And it's not me. It's the message, and it's in the message that makes God look strong. That makes God look beautiful. That makes God look amazing, and that makes God look big. And Paul wanted this gospel and this God to look as big as he actually is. So God, we thank you this morning that our faith does not rest on the gimmicks of man, but it rests on the power of God. Jesus Christ crucified. Would you just help us fall in love with that simple gospel again this morning? Thank you, God, for forgiving my sin. Thank you, God, for forgiving the ways I've hid from you. Thank you, God, for forgiving the ways I've hurt people. Thank you, God, for not just forgiving me, but then offering me the abundant life. Would you make our church powerful in gospel proclamation, both here and sisters, but with our global partners around the world as well? For Abigail and Calvary and Hope Africa and, yeah, where all of our missionaries are, God, they're doing gospel stuff. We pray for them. God, for Dustin, too, with the youth and Young Life as well, please make these guys powerful for your work in their generation. Lord, help us not to just critique and lose heart. Help us to see the moment we're in, size it up, and know what to do. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for this church body. Feed us this morning at the table. In Christ's name, amen. This morning, I want to invite you, as we do every Sunday, and this really is, in so many ways, the center point of our faith, the table. It's where we have a meal with King Jesus. We can't impart that which we do not possess. And so we need to be fed again, because the vision leaks not just institutionally, it leaks in our own hearts. So I want to invite you to grab the elements, and these are all elders at the table. If you need to pray with any of them, you just grab them, okay? And these guys are here to pray with you, to do soul care with you, to connect with you. And then when you get your elements, you can take it back, and I'll lead us from up front in a few minutes.
I'm forgiven because you were forsaken, and I'm accepted. You were condemned. I'm alive and well. Your spirit is within me because you died and rose again. Amazing love, how can it be that you, my King, would die for me? Amazing love, I know it's true. It's my joy to honor you in all I do. I honor you. Amazing love, how can it be that you, my King, would die for me? Amazing love, I know it's true. It's my joy to honor you in all I do. I honor you.
Friends, we don't need a better version of ourselves, but as the hymn said earlier that we sang, yet not I, but Christ in me. Christ in me, that's the John 15 original wine discourse. Abide in me, and I'm gonna come abide in you. And so we take these elements today to very seriously and honestly say, Jesus, we need to take you in, all of you, into us. And so, Jesus, we thank you for the bread, your body, sinless, guiltless, perfect, broken, though. We take that broken life and that broken body, we eat it in remembrance of you. And thank you for the blood, perfect, spotless Lamb of God slain. Without the shedding of blood, there's no forgiveness, but because you, Jesus, you actually loved us, pray we would drink this to the glory of God. Let's stand together and go out singing this song.
I'm forgiven because you were forsaken, and I'm accepted, you were condemned. I'm alive and well, your spirit is within me because you died and rose. Amazing love, how can it be that you, my King, would die for me? Amazing love, I know it's true. It's my joy to honor in all I do, I honor you. And you are my King. You are my King. And Jesus, you. Jesus, you are my King. You are my King. Jesus, you are my King.
As we do our send-off, Ryan mentioned that we can't give out that which we have not taken. Well, we've come. We've asked Jesus to come into our life, and now we go. And this was written before Jesus came, but it was talking about Jesus coming and what God would do for us in Jesus. And when we've received that, we can leave this place and take that with us and have the peace that his face does shine upon us. So as this is like a commissioning to go live out that which we've taken. So let's all say it together. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. So let's do that this week. And don't forget your junior hires over in the hangar. They're being held hostage for a price. Amen. We'll see you. Hey, how are you?
I've called your name some broken night, and you showed up and patched me up like you do every time. I get amnesia, I forget that you keep coming around. Yeah, ain't no way you ever let me down. Good God Almighty, I hope you find me praising your name. Say your love goes on forever, that your mercy never stops. So why would I assume you'll be somebody that you're not? Like sun in the morning, I know you're gonna be there every day. So what on earth could make me be afraid? Good God Almighty,